this. Young people, I need y'all to come right down here in front of the stage.
Motivation. Hey, we just want to take the time to welcome you to the Motivation Online experience today. And although we're watching online, we just want to thank you for spending the weekend with us.
My name is Jenny.
And my name is Mac.
Before Lady Ray gets us kicked off into worship, let us know where you're watching the service from today. Write it in the comments. Rep your hood in the comments below.
And also, let us know how you're feeling today. If you're feeling great, throw in a green heart. But if you feel a little mellow yellow, you can throw in a yellow heart. But if you feel like you need to be fed with the word, throw in a red heart.
Be sure to comment your hearts in the comment section. During service, one of our online hosts will be praying for you during service.
And last week was such an amazing time in fellowship.
Oh, yes.
And if
it
you
was.
Happen to miss it, here's a quick recap.
Bring it back.
Show me what you're working with. Oh, yeah, I know I'm showing my age. Thank you, Mr. Cole. Everybody wants to follow the trend instead of setting the trend. When you are a person of purpose, you don't get intimidated by other success. You get inspired. God wants to anoint the authentic you. When we copy everyone else, we reject the opportunity for God to be creative through us. He can only produce from what you possess. God only requires you to use what you have. You are carrying something, and what you're carrying may not be obvious to everybody else, but it's obvious to God. And
oh my goodness, that was such an amazing word by Pastor Jay. If you want to watch the rest of that message and catch so many more, make sure you subscribe to our Motivation YouTube channel.
Do it.
Before we get started, we want to remind you that we have an amazing Good Friday service that you don't want to miss. It'll be streaming from our Facebook and YouTubes, and it will feature our amazing speakers that are located here at Motivation. You don't want to miss it.
Now, Jaden, here with the announcements.
No, that's trash. What are we doing?
Jaden, take it away.
No. Jaden, now here's Jaden with the announcements. Do it. Just do it regular. What is happening? Right.
Now, here's Jaden with the announcements.
No, give the flavor.
Deep breath.
Right.
Flush it out.
2 hours later.
Now, here's Jaden with the announcements.
Motivation, it's Jaden, and you're tuned in to the Motivation News and Announcements. Motivators, listen up. We have a team that is here to support you whenever you need it. Whether you just experienced a life event like a marriage, a newborn baby, or even the loss of a loved one, you can always email village@motivationchurch.org. Village people are here to support you. You can send them your notifications and requests, and they'll get back to you. If you have not become an official motivator yet, you can email members@motivationchurch.org so that you can register for Next Steps. Next Steps courses 101 to 104 will be held every Sunday after church at 2 p.m. If you're new, make sure that you don't miss it because it's going to teach you how you can stay connected and live a motivated life. Wasn't Ladies Night amazing? If you missed it, it's okay because you can always join us next time. and to figure out what next time is, make sure that you're following us at She Motivates Facebook page, because then it helps you keep up to date. And speaking of social media, make sure that you're following us on all our platforms. Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube, because you do not want to miss what we have coming out. It helps you stay connected, and you don't want to miss all the fire stuff that is getting posted. We have one more special announcement for you, so Dad, take it from here.
Thanks, Jaden. Listen, everybody, we are excited about what God is doing, and I get to share this special announcement. As we're getting ready, we are 1 week away. Come on, everybody, come on, 1 week. We're 1 week away from the Super Bowl of church. You know it, I know it, we know what it is. It is Resurrection Sunday, AKA Easter, and we're excited to get together. We are coming back together for our boost service. What does that mean? Simply means that we need a boost. We haven't seen each other in so long. And so myself with the leaders sat down, we prayed, we talked, we planned this out. And so next weekend, as you know, we're having two services in person right here. Well, not here, but y'all know, right at the church. We're getting together and we're gonna connect. We have a 10 a.m. worship experience that's also gonna be on Facebook Live and YouTube. And then there's also a 12 o'clock worship experience. So listen, we packed it out and we filled registration within 22 hours. God is doing something amazing. And my heart goes out to all of our motivators who are not gonna be able to be in the building in person, but trust me, tune in, lock in, lean in online. God has something in store just for you. While we're getting ready to celebrate this awesome weekend, our theme for Easter, y'all ready? Drum roll, please. Our theme for Easter is It's the Cross for Me. Oh yeah, and to celebrate this, we got motivation gear. Y'all check it out. We got the safety green. Boom, we got the orange. Boom, we got the pink. Oh my God, we're excited. If you didn't get your tee, I don't know what's wrong with you. These t-shirts have sold like hotcakes. Now, I don't know if we have any on deck, but if you want to order one, email jasmine@motivationchurch.org and she will make sure she puts you on our order form and we'll let you know how you can get your shirt. But it's going to be amazing. And so we are excited about next weekend. It's gonna be crazy. You don't wanna miss it. Shameless plug. Let me just go ahead. Don't tell nobody. But we're working on some new gear. Oh yeah! Ah, we're going crazy out here in these streets. We got so much stuff happening. It's gonna be great. Motivation, we love you. And we can't wait for you to join us for Easter weekend at Motivation Church. Now, before we go, we're getting ready to start worship in a second. We're going back to Jenny. But listen, if you are ready to give, this is part of our worship experience where we get to sow and be a blessing to the kingdom of God. And so right now, right where you are, go ahead, it's early, I know, but go ahead and get your tablets out, get your money out, get your checkbooks out, get your cash app out, do what you gotta do, and we are gonna give together. The Bible says to bring the seed, bring the offering, bring the tithe into the storehouse so that there can be sufficient ministry in the house of God. And so each week as we give and as we honor God with our giving, God continues to give us more than enough. Come on, somebody just say, God gives us more than enough. Listen, even if you didn't get that stimulus check, God is still provided. Even if you got the stimmy, God still provided. I'm just glad that we serve a God who's faithful, amazing, and consistent. So come on, do me a favor. Lift your seed with me and say this. Come on, let's say it together. Lord, with this seed, I'm expecting a great harvest in your kingdom and in my life. Sounds so good, we should say it again. Lord, with this seed, I'm expecting a great harvest in your kingdom and in my life. Hey, we're going back to Jenny. I'll see you guys in a minute.
Hey, family, are you ready? Worship is getting ready to start. Grab your family, grab your friends. Worship's about to start right now. Let's go!
It's time to give God glory. It's time to give him, he strengthened you. Now God, you get the glory. God of the good and the bad, you get the glory. In spite of it all, you get the glory. Surrendered heart, God, you get the glory.
Let's get ready. Let's get ready to pray. Let us pray. Father God, I just come before you and I just worship you, God, for you are so good. You are so amazing, God. God, this morning put it on my heart that you are a big God. We don't serve a small God. Yes, thank God we don't serve a small God. Thank you for putting that in my spirit today to remind me that in the midst of chaos, in the midst of trouble, that you are a big God. That you'll provide. You'll make the way, God. You'll open doors that no man can open for us. And we thank you, God, that we can stand firm on your word. Thank you, God, that when obstacles and anything that comes our way, God, we don't have to fear. Because you are with us, God. We stand on your promises. We stand on your truth today. That you are good. That you are holy. That you are Alpha and Omega. That you're beginning and the end, God. We thank you. We just thank you, God. We just worship you, God. That we give our all to you, God. We give our all that we have today. And whatever we're standing in need of, whatever is blocking us, God, remove it right now so we can hear from you. We can see what you have for us, God. When all the heaviness in the world, God, I know that I can rest on you. I can trust in you that nothing can stand in our way, God, when our eyes are on you, Jesus. Help us to keep our eyes on you, God. No matter what, God, you are big. You are good. And you provide, God. So provide for us. Continue to comfort us and protect us, God. And whatever we're standing in need of, God, that we just lift our hands and we trust, God. And we give it to you, God. And we glorify you. We honor you, God. We worship your holy name today for all that you do and for who you are. Have your way today. Have your way, God, that will give you the best praise, God. The best praise, God, because you are worthy, God. You are worthy. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah. I thank you, God. And I pray all these things in your precious name. Amen.
Hallelujah. As we begin to continue in worship, come on, can you just think about the good things he's done? Come on, there's a lot going on, but there's a lot of good things he's done. There's a lot of ways he's made. There's a lot of paths he went that was crooked that he made straight. Come on, can we think on those things now? Come on, Yahweh, the one who brings into existence, he is going to be praised forever and ever, forever and always. Yahweh, Yahweh, Yahweh.
Come on, can we stay there always?
Always.
Come on, Jesus be praised.
Jesus be praised. Jesus,
yeah.
Be praised. Jesus be praised. Jesus be praised. Jesus be praised.
Come on, one more time, Jesus.
Jesus.
This is a sweet moment in his presence. And so let's just take a posture of praise, a posture to receive from the Lord. And so, Father, we thank you right now for this moment. God, we thank you for showing up and showing yourself to us. God, we know that sometimes we can be emotional. We can be in our feelings. But God, our praise is not about how we feel. Our praise is about what we know. And we know in spite of how we feel that you're a good God. And so God, we give you our praise. We give you our attention. We give you our focus. God, we give you our worship. God, we give it all to you. And so today we eliminate the distractions, the things that are blocking us, whether it's something physical in front of us, or something mental that we're thinking about, or something emotional that we're dealing with. We cast our cares on you because we know that you care for us. And in exchange for our cares, God, we receive your joy. We receive your peace. We receive the hope that comes from Jesus alone. And so God, in the next few moments, speak a word to us that will help us grow in our faith, that will draw us closer to you, that would help us to hide behind the cross and apply the blood of Jesus to our lives. And God, we thank you in advance that in spite of what we were going through before this experience, we know that we're gonna leave better because you're gonna be bigger in our lives. Just like David said, magnify the Lord with me and we exalt your name together. So God, in this space, we make you bigger. In this space, we make your name louder. In this space, we call on the name of Jesus. In this space, we cast our cares on you. In this space, we take upon your yoke. In this space, we're believing you because what's impossible with man is possible with God. And so, Lord, we just say, have your way. Do what you want to do. Move in this place. And we give you praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's give our God a great shout of praise today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Savior. Hallelujah. Yes. Anybody glad to be in the presence of the Lord today? Yes, the Bible declares that this is the day the Lord has made. We choose to rejoice and to be glad in it. And we welcome you to Motivation Church. God's presence and power is here. I know y'all comfortable on the couch. You've been chilling in the living room. You in the kitchen right now frying up some eggs. But I'm telling you, you better pause the eggs and the pancakes because God has a word for you today. We have, in this season that we're in, we've started this new series called The Crosswalker. It's going to be on the screen for you. We're excited about what God is doing in our lives, and I don't want to give you too much of a spoiler alert, but I'm telling you, if you peek into what God has been saying all year long, every message has been prophetic by nature. And it's not been something that we're just throwing out there and saying a bunch of words. No, it's been God really speaking to us, to our situation, and where he wants us to go and where he wants us to grow. Somebody just shout, I'm growing this year. This is a year that we're growing in a different way. And God has been challenging us. And as you know, 2020 was a crazy year. It was a year, an unprecedented year, a year of so many unexpected things and things that we couldn't even imagine was even possible. And we made it. Go ahead and just tell somebody, say, I made it. I made it. I made it. And we're still making it. God is still doing some things. He's still saving us and delivering us. And so 2021, we came into this year, and God spoke to us and gave us a word that just says, walk with me. And it seems simple by nature, but it's prophetic in nature, because God wants us to walk with him. And so I want to get into this message. We are in Palm Sunday. This is the Sunday before Easter. Oh, yeah. Super Bowl Sunday is next week. But this is Palm Sunday. This is the prelude to everything that's getting ready to happen on the cross. And I want to share some things with you today. Now, this message that I'm getting ready to share with you, I want you to pay attention to it, because this is a message normally we would preach on Easter. This is a message that we would preach on Easter Sunday to get everybody excited about Jesus getting up off the cross. And we're going to talk about all that. But I think there's some things, and y'all know when God starts messing with me, how it gets a little crazy in here. And so I want us to lean in today. This is a lean in message. And I got to tell you this at the beginning, because I'm just going to hit it and go. I want to tell you that 90% of people who take notes when I preach, you know where they go. Oh, yeah, they go to heaven. And so we want to get ready. And I want you to get ready to receive the word. I want you to get ready. I want you to share it right now before we even read the scripture. Share this right now. Come on, it's Sunday morning. They're at home. Gym's not even open yet. So I want you to get ready, because we're going to go somewhere. Thank you, Sean. We're good. I want to go here. Luke chapter 23. Luke chapter 23. We're just going to read a few verses. 23. We're going to read verses 38 through 43 in the NLT. Luke chapter 23, 38 through 43 in the NLT. That kind of rhymed. I told you I was a rapper in my former life. I can't help it. But let's go there. When you got it, somebody just shout, I'm ready. All right, that sounds good. It says, a sign was fastened above him, Jesus, with these words, this is the King of the Jews. And one of the criminals hanging beside him scoffed. That's kind of funny, right? Scoffed. Like he was laughing. He was clowning Jesus. That's what it's really saying. That's the ghetto translation. So you're the Messiah? Are you? Prove it by saving yourself. Oh, yeah. And us too. And while you're at it, and then he says, but the other criminal protested and he said, don't you fear God? Even when you have been sentenced to die, we deserve to die for our crimes. But this man, he's talking about Jesus, this man hasn't done anything wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Here's the dope thing. Jesus looks back, looks at a plan. He says, I assure you, today you will be with me in paradise. I want to teach this a little bit, and I want to preach from the subject, crucial conflict. Yeah. I want to talk about crucial conflict. As we look at this text, the crazy thing about this text, when you look at it, it's challenging. Because you have Jesus who is led to Golgotha. That was the place of the skull. It was the place of death, right? Because the Romans, they were known for killing people. They were like professional hitmen. They knew how to just mess with you, tear you apart. And they had a way to make you suffer a long time. They could keep you alive while they're killing you. It was interesting what they were good at. And so this place called Golgotha was a place of death. It was the place of the skull. And while they bring Jesus there, we'll talk about some of this next week. They bring Jesus to Golgotha. He's innocent. They bring him before Pilate. Pilate's like, what did he do? Nobody can say what he did. They just didn't like him. They're just like, crucify him. He's like, what did they do? Crucify him. But what did he do? Crucify him. What did he do? Crucify him. He's like, all right, cool. He's like, this ain't got nothing to do with me. I'm going to give you what you want. And they said, while you crucify him, give us Barabbas. Says, give us Barabbas. Barabbas was a guy, he was kind of like known as a freedom fighter, kind of, but he was a revolutionary, but he was also kind of, some people say he was a rapist. He was in there for certain things, certain crimes that he committed, and he was kind of a menace in society. So Barabbas, they say, I'd rather have Barabbas than Jesus. Interesting that we're talking about something that happened over 2,000 years ago, but it still seems like things haven't changed. That people would rather everything else except Jesus. So they bring Jesus to Golgotha, and they bring him to Golgotha. He's now walking. Ethiopian dude brother looks at Jesus like, I got your back. Helps Jesus walk with the cross, brings him to the place of death. They put Jesus on the cross. Now, this is the crazy part about all of this. Jesus, he's on the cross. He's dying slow. And he's having this conversation, and shameless plug, I can't wait for Good Friday because we have some preachers that are going to be sharing seven last words. Excited about that. But they're going to talk about the things that Jesus said on the cross. But we don't just look at what Jesus said. We have to look at what Jesus did. Because it's important to recognize the importance of how Jesus lived, but it's also important to see how Jesus died. Jesus, a lot of people say Jesus was murdered. He was killed. And to a degree, that's true. But the reality is Jesus really wasn't murdered. If we could be honest, Jesus even said himself, he said, you can't, in other words, you can't look at everybody else, he said, because no man can take my life. That's murder, when you take someone's life. He said, but I lay it down freely. So Jesus paints this picture while he's dying. He's laying himself down because, you know, the Bible says that he is the lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. And here's the good news for you. That means that Jesus died for your sins before you even sinned. That it was always God's plan to save us from our sin and be in relationship with us. And he does that before he dies. He does it before we even live. So Jesus now, he's on the cross, and this is where it gets fun. Jesus is on the cross dying, and they have the nerve to put Jesus between two thieves. Jesus is chilling in the middle between two thieves. You got one on the right, one on the left, and one of the thieves is looking at him crazy, right? We read in the text. And here's the thing. While they're having this conversation, let me tell you what's going on around the cross. Around the cross, they were rolling dice for his clothes. Jesus was beat so bad that you couldn't even recognize him. They beat the skin off of him. They beat him so bad that you couldn't even tell it was Jesus. The Bible says that he was unrecognizable. They beat him with the cat of nine tails. They put a crown of thorns on his head. I know it's not Easter yet, but we got to go somewhere. Jesus is doing all of this to show us something. What is he showing us? He's showing us the ugliness of our sin. When we think it's just a small sin, a little white lie, it's not that big of a deal. God knows my heart. Y'all know, come on, anybody have one of those God knows my heart moments? It's not that bad. I'm gonna get it together. Jesus is showing us a picture of what not having it together looks like. He's showing us a picture of what sin looks like. He's showing us a picture of what we deserve. And so Jesus now, he's on the cross. I gotta hurry up. Jesus is on the cross and he's between these two thieves. They're rolling dice for his clothes. They're spitting on him. They're laughing at him. They're like, ha ha, you thirsty? And they try to mess with him and give him some foolish vinegar. And they giving him stuff and they're making fun of him. And they don't understand, how could people follow someone like this? This is your king? That's what they're really saying. And here's the part that got me. Above his head, they had a sign that was written in Hebrew, Greek, and Aramaic or Latin. It said, the King of the Jews. They weren't doing that as a good thing. They were trying to do that as a funny thing. They were trying to clown Jesus. But here's one of the things I learned about God, that God will get glory even through the worst situation. Because what I've learned in 2021, shameless plug, check out our YouTube page, because what I've learned, it's not just the picture that matters, it's the caption you use. Because the caption is what causes you to get my attention. They put a caption up thinking it was gonna clown him, but really it was gonna crown him. And can I tell somebody this morning that there's some things that people tried to clown you with, but God said, I'm gonna use it to crown you with. That's why the Bible says all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. So the very thing that they used to clown you, God said, I'm going to use to crown you. Jesus has this caption above his head, and the caption above his head is really suggestive. So when people say things to you, this is what I want to throw in here for free. You got to be careful what you accept from people, because one thing I've learned is that you think prophecy is just when someone says, the Lord says. God told me to tell you, you're going to be rich. Hallelujah. God says this is your year to get married. Hallelujah. This year you're going to eat all you want and still lose weight. Hallelujah. We get excited about all of that. And we love those prophetic words. But can I tell you, when you are spiritual, there is another way to receive prophetic words. Can I teach you? Because the Bible says that Satan is the father of all lies, that the truth is not in him. And sometimes Satan uses people to prophesy. Oh God. So sometimes people will tell you you're a failure, but because Satan was the one speaking through them and he's the one speaking to you, he can't tell the truth. So when he tells you you're a failure, he's just prophesying in reverse, and he's letting you know that you're already a winner. You've already succeeded. You've already overcome. Don't think prophetic words are just going to be from prophets in the pulpit. It's going to be devils in the street. They're going to say some things, and every time they try to clown you with words and put things over your head, you don't have to receive what they're saying. Receive what they're not saying, because God can even speak through demons. Jesus, he's King of the Jews over his head. And this message of salvation through faith was about Christ, how he was crucified and suffer for our sins. And Jesus now becomes a stumbling block for many people because they don't see how Jesus can save us when he couldn't save himself. How is it that this is our King, but it looked like he need help? How can I ask someone who's broke for some money? How can I ask someone who's lonely for advice? How can I go to someone who seems like they need help themselves? They're looking at this, and this is conflict. And many of us, I want to break this down today in the next few moments, because many of us in our walk with God, we are going to experience conflict. If you never have conflict in your walk with God, my question is, who are you really walking with? It is impossible. Let me say it again. It is impossible to walk with God and not have conflict. The very fact that you believe in Jesus is already conflict. It's in conflict with nature. It's in conflict with your flesh. It's in conflict with reasonable thinking. It's in conflict with going against what's in front of you, what society says. Everybody say conflict. Jesus on the cross is teaching us about the conflict of the walk with Christ. And this is more than just some Jewish guy who claims to be the savior of the world. This is more than a man who's rejected by his own people. It's more than some dude who's just performing miracles, signs, and wonders. It's more than just a guy who stood for peace and was a nice guy like people say Gandhi was. No, this is about our God and him dying for our sins, bringing us back to life, bringing us into relationship with himself, and teaching us how to walk this thing out. Because as much as you hear the gospel, it's just as important to know how to walk this thing out. Because many people will leave next Sunday, they will leave from Easter service, and they'll be excited and stop walking. And many people leave their walk at church, they leave their walk at the building, because they don't know how to deal with the conflict of the walk. So I want to talk, can I talk about crucial conflict just for a moment? This teaches us a couple of things. Number one, it teaches us how God rescues his people from the hand of the enemy. Teaches us how God redeems his creation. But it also teaches us how God reveals himself through the Son. And it's important that when we look at our walk with God, these things are clear. God rescues his people from the hand of the enemy. The Bible says in Colossians 1 and verse 13, it says, for he has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his dear son. Everybody say, I am rescued. He also teaches us that he redeems his creation. That means that mankind is in a fallen state, that we were born into sin and shaping in iniquity. Okay, y'all like that. Let me remix this. We were born needing help. that's all he's saying. So he redeems his creation through his sacrifice. Colossians 1 verse 14 tells us he purchased our freedom and forgave our sins. This is the good part. You got to understand that he forgave our sins. Catch this. He forgave our sins. It doesn't say he will forgive. It says he forgave, which means that before I did it, he already did it. He forgave me before I did it. So even though I sinned, once I asked, it was already available. Now, let me just be clear, because there's some people who think you don't even have to acknowledge Jesus because Jesus died for all sin. That means we're automatically going to die and go to heaven because Jesus died for all sin, which to a degree is true. He died for all sin, but you got to make sure that you check in with Jesus to get your ticket. Okay, it's no different than if I give you a check for $1 million, and it's a good check because I got $1 million in the bank. But here's the thing I'm telling you, you're not a millionaire just because you have the check. Just because the check is available, you have to sign it and deposit it. You have to acknowledge that you're taking ownness. You're taking responsibility of what was handed to you. You can't have what Jesus offers if you don't accept Jesus. So we got to understand he redeems his creation, and he also reveals himself through the image of his son. Jesus, I always say Jesus is God's selfie, you know, because like if God took a selfie, you would see Jesus. But I thought about something a little different. He's not just God's selfie. He's also God's thumbnail. Oh, yeah. If you really want to see a thumbnail of God move, you'll see Jesus. Jesus reveals himself, and we see it in Colossians 1:15. It says Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. That's why the Bible tells us in him all things were created, and by him and for him and without him nothing that was made was made. That's what makes Jesus God. It's not that he's the son like a little boy. Jesus is the capital S-O-N. Son really means self. He is God's selfie. He is God in the flesh. So when we see Jesus, we see God. And what separates him is that angels were created. You and I were created, animals were created, all of creation, everything was created except him, because there's nobody that created God. So Jesus is God, and he existed eternally with the Father in heaven. Somebody shout, thank God for Jesus. So watch this, we got to go. We have a Jesus who's innocent, and he's on the cross, and he's doing a whole bunch of things. There's things that God does that he doesn't always say. Let me catch you here. There's sometimes God is moving and working when he's not speaking. And sometimes we're waiting for God to speak and we're missing God moving. Don't miss the move of God because you don't hear the voice of God. There are things that God is moving and orchestrating in our life and doing even when we don't recognize it. Somebody shout, he's always working. He's always working. He's always working. He's dying on the cross. Even between words, he was working. He was working. He was working. He was doing a work that they didn't even recognize. That's why one thief said, you need to save yourself. The other thief said, don't you respect God? Because while one person sees God one way, another person sees God another way. And Jesus, before he even speaks to them, he's already working. And can I tell you that God has been working in your life even when you don't see it? Through this pandemic, even days when you got sick, he was still working. If he kept you from getting sick, he was still working. If you kept your job and worked from home, he was still working. If you stayed home and got a stimmy, he was still working. Whatever you experience, God has still been working. And he's now understanding this. Gary said it wonderfully. He said the human intention of the cross was to take Jesus' life, but God's intention of the cross was to give us life. Let me say that again. Some of y'all slow but worth waiting for. I need you to get this by Tuesday. He said the human intention of the cross was to take Jesus' life, but God's intention of the cross was to give us life. And I need you to understand that he was working even while he wasn't speaking. So there's three areas of conflict I got to give you in the next 12 minutes, and we got to go. Here's the first thing I want you to see, because while he's at the cross, there's a bunch of people, there's a crowd, there are people watching, they're looking at the sign, King of the Jews, and they're trying to figure out what's going on with this dude. You had Mary, the mother of Jesus. You had his aunt, Mary's sister. You had Mary, the wife of Cleophas. You had Mary, a whole lot of Marys. You had all these Marys. You had John, the beloved disciple, the one that Jesus loved. You had John. And then you have Joseph of Arimathea. He was the Jewish council member that got permission to take Jesus' body. You had all of these people at the cross witnessing this, having an experience. They're looking at their king. They're looking at their savior. They're looking at their Lord. They're looking at their friend. They're looking at the one that they walk with for 3.5 years. Mom was walking with him for 33.5 years. But they're looking at this guy. They're looking and they're trying to figure out, what is our faith going to be now that our Savior is being killed? Imagine the fact that everything you believe looks like it's dying in front of you. Jesus is, he's dying on the cross, but he's still working. They're wondering, but he's still working. And we see this area of conflict. Here's the first thing I want you to write down. Check this out. I know it's Sunday morning, but it'll be good to you. Check this out. Number one, the conflict of pain and purpose. It's one of the big areas why people fall off and they don't walk with God outside of church. Because Jesus, he goes through pain to produce our prescription. Sometimes, can I say it this way? Sometimes pain is the prescription. Sometimes pain fixes the problem. All right. There's some things that if it wasn't for the pain, you wouldn't stop doing it.
Come on.
There's some things that if pain wasn't inflicted, you would just stay right where you were. And I'm grateful because there's been, can we just have a truth moment on a Sunday? There's been areas of my life where I've got caught up and messed up in my sin, and I was struggling with it before, but after being caught and blown up and messed up, all of a sudden, I got delivered real quick. Sometime trouble and pain will deliver you from your dilemma. Pain became the prescription. And you have to understand that if Jesus didn't take it there, if he didn't take pain and he didn't take the pain of the cross, there would be no remedy for our sin. So he bears our sins on the cross. And I want to tell you that when you are a person of purpose, sometimes you'll have a conflict because pain comes, and pain will make you question, is God really there? Oh yeah, it's one of those things like John the Baptist. Think about this. John the Baptist, Jesus' cousin. He was in the womb. The Bible says he was the only person that had the Holy Spirit in the womb, jumping around. He's in Elizabeth's room. He's there, Mary and Elizabeth chilling. They dancing. Jesus in there. They in the womb dancing. They going like this. In my mind, that's what they were doing. Anyway, and so we see that there's an exchange, that John the Baptist was full of the Holy Ghost. He's the forerunner. He's the one who has the opportunity to go out and talk about Jesus before Jesus shows up on the scene. He's preaching the kingdom at hand. Repent of your sins. John the Baptist is that guy, wild dude. I'm telling you, he was the first director of Wildin' Out. He was in the wilderness. He was in the woods eating all kind of honeycombs and all these different things. He was a wild boy. John the Baptist. But even John the Baptist, after experiencing, he's the guy who, imagine being the guy who baptizes Jesus. Jesus shows up. He's like, come on, I'm going to be. He's like, I'm not even worthy. He's like, Jesus, come on, man, do it. He baptized Jesus. He's walking around like, yo, I baptized Jesus. Imagine putting that. What job couldn't you get if you wanted to baptize Jesus? Like, you could do any. Imagine that on your resume. Like, he went to Avon High School, played basketball. Oh, I see you baptized Jesus. I mean, what wouldn't be available to you on your resume if you baptized Jesus? And John, y'all crazy. John the Baptist baptizes Jesus. But even when John gets in trouble, he sends a message to Jesus and says, are you the one, or should we look for another? Do you know what kind of pain you have to be in to question what you already know to be true? He's in pain. And sometimes it's conflict, the conflict of pain and purpose. But I also learned that they're closely connected, because everybody in purpose will always experience pain. Because there's something about pain that draws purpose out of you. The Bible says in Ephesians 1:7, he is so rich in kindness and grace that he purchased our freedom with the blood of his son and forgave our sins. You got to understand that trusting God is faith's will. Check this out. Trusting God is faith's will. Trusting yourself is flesh's will. And so when you are in conflict, when you are in pain and you're trying to battle between, is this where I'm supposed to be? Can I just say this? Don't lean to your own will. And a lot of times we'll do whatever it takes to get out of pain. You know, so we smoke to get out of pain. Well, it's natural. I'm just saying. Let me tell you something. Can I just go here? You know how many people smell like skunks every day? I was in the store, this young lady walking. I'm like, oh my, I couldn't even be in it. She smelled bad. And her eyes red. She just walking around looking crazy. And you know, I have these young people I talk to, and they're like, oh, you know, you understand, it's natural. If God didn't want me to have it, he wouldn't put it on the earth. And they say all these things. Well, in the Bible, it doesn't say smoking is a sin. But let me help you with something. Anything that takes away your ability to be sober, anything that takes away your awareness and you being acute, anything that causes you to lose being on point. And there's some of y'all creatives. Let me just help you here. There's some of y'all creatives that I can't even create nothing without being high, without getting drunk. I need something to take my mind to another place. And that's the problem. Every time your mind goes to another place, you're allowing another spirit to enter in and take control, and you don't even recognize it. That's why there's some people that are being used and don't even recognize what they're being used by, because they're entertaining spirits. I'm just saying, be careful, because pain will lead you to try to preserve yourself. But every person that's a person of purpose will experience pain. And the reason we have to recognize this is because humanity and divinity will always be at odds. It will always be. That's why Jesus, when he's praying, he's getting ready to be crucified. Even prior to this, Jesus is getting ready to be crucified. And he's like, oh, I don't want to do it. And he goes and he spends some time with the Father. And he says, I don't want to do this. Let this cup pass from me. And he says, but nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Now, some people will say, well, that proves that Jesus isn't God, because he says he has a will and God has a will. That's not what he's saying, that him and God are at odds. He's really talking between humanity and divinity, because he didn't switch. This is called modalism. I don't want to get into this too much. This is people that don't believe that God, they don't believe in the Trinity. They believe in modalism, that God came in modes. He came in the mode as the Father. Then he switched modes to the Son. Then he switched modes to the Spirit. That's called modalism, or oneness. Now, here's the issue with that. If that was the case, then Jesus could not exist at the same time as the Father. Doesn't make sense. So you have to look at, it wasn't that Jesus was 50% human and 50% divinity or divine. It was the simple fact that he was 100% man and he was 100% God. And so in his humanity had a desire to say, I don't want to take this beating. But in his divinity, he knew he had to do this, because pain and purpose go together. Everybody say the conflict of pain and purpose. Let me give you the second one. We got to go. The second thing I want you to write down is the conflict of brokenness and belief. The conflict of brokenness and belief. It wasn't just the one thief that believed it, but it was also the Roman officer overseeing the process that we see that he turns from a warrior into a worshiper. Because I told you, even when he's not speaking, he's still working. And it wasn't just the words that he said when he was dying, but even in his dying, he was saving. Because while others were having different moments and they had a different lens of what was going on the cross, the Bible says that the Roman officer that watched, by the time it was over, said he is truly the Son of God. Because there was something big about Jesus that beyond his words, he died with dignity. Yeah, his brokenness is what led to this man's belief. And can I tell you something? That's why it's equally important how you go through hard moments for the world to see. Because there are some people that can't believe you while you're whole. There are some people that are watching you while you're broken. And can I tell you, some of the best work that you do, some of the best ways that you trust God, is not when you get that stimulus check. It's not when you got a raise. It's not when you got a bonus. It's not when you got the contract. Not when you went on tour. Not when you got everything you work for. Sometimes it's when you were broken. It's when you were broke. It's when you were lonely. It's when you were discouraged. It's when you didn't have anybody that could understand you. It's when your private issues went public and people can see you in your broken state. That's when people say, you must believe in something that's really real, because this is beyond emotions. I would have lost my mind a long time ago, but because of the grace of God. And there's some people that will believe because of your brokenness. Brokenness. There's a conflict of brokenness and belief. And many people come into this not hearing messages like this. They don't hear about being broken as a believer. And understand that every believer, to be a believer, must be broken. Oh my God. Because if you're not broken, you can't believe. You don't come into this whole. You don't come into this just believing. No, you got to recognize the sin in your life. You have to recognize the brokenness in your life. And when you give it to Jesus, he can take what's broken. The Bible says a contrite spirit and a broken heart. God, a broken spirit and a contrite heart, the Lord will not despise. That means God is attracted to your brokenness. When he draws close to you and you draw close to him through your brokenness, it leads other people to believe. And that's why even when you're at work, watch your words. Oh, yeah. Even wherever you are. Come on. Somebody just say, watch your words. Watch your words, because it affects how people see you, and it affects how people hear you, and it affects how people receive you. You wonder why some people will never go to church with some people. It's because they were watching your words. Oh, yeah. They heard you say, praise the Lord. They watch you watch on YouTube. They watch you subscribe, like, and share. They like you doing all that stuff, but they also listen to you at the cooler talking about your husband. They also listen to you talk about your boss. They also saw you taking extra long lunches. They also saw you doing some things that weren't godly things, and they are watching you in the times of brokenness to see what you really believe. Because the truth is, it's not your faith that speaks the loudest on the mountaintop. It's your faith when you're in the valley that shows us what you really believe. Jesus, he's teaching about the conflict of brokenness. The Roman officer, he watches this whole thing take place. And he says, surely this man was innocent. And when the crowd came to see what happened, he was in deep sorrow because he saw Jesus die with dignity. And let me tell you this, and we got to go to the last point, is that there's a blessing in your brokenness. That's why Paul says it like this. He says, when I'm weak, you're strong. So I'll boast in my weakness, because in my weakness, your strength is made perfect. In other words, let me remix that for 2021. Can I do that? In other words, he says, I ain't got to flex all the time, because when I'm not flexing, you're flexing. He's showing us that in our brokenness, God is strong. There's a blessing in our brokenness. Let me give you this last thing, because we got to go. Can I just pause here for 1 second? And let me say this to you. As believers, we don't want to die, but thank you, Biggie. We're ready to die because we're living for life. we're living for life. And many people aren't living for life. They're living for now. And we're living to live again. And so we have to remember that even in our brokenness, God is still blessing us. I'm blessed when I'm broken. Okay, let me hurry up, because we got to go. The last thing I want you to write down is the conflict of conviction. Conflict of conviction. This is the revelation of Christ that leads to the regeneration of life. I know you like that one, Jodine. That rap, that rhymed. I was a rapper, I told y'all. Let me say it again. It's the revelation of Christ that leads to the regeneration of life. This man on the cross, he sees Jesus in this moment while one dude's trying to clown him, the other thief is trying to crown him, and he says, he confesses about Jesus, and he says, remember me when you enter your kingdom. It's this understanding that once I see Jesus for who he really is, once he is really revealed to me, then I can accept what he offers. Many people are trying to accept what he offers before they have a revelation of who he is. So the problem is, if we don't know him, we don't know how to handle him. We don't know how to receive him if we don't know him. Okay, it's like this. If I walk in a room and I'm joking and I say, man, oh, you stupid, man. This dude's dumb. You're stupid. Somebody who doesn't know me will say, he's rude. He came in there just loud, talking crazy. I can't be around people like that. How can y'all be in a church with a pastor who tell people they're stupid and dumb and they got all these things to say? And then you'll look like, Shut up. Because if you knew him, you wouldn't even think that way. Because they don't have a revelation of who I am, they can't really receive how I am. They can't receive from me because they have a wrong perspective of me. And many people are trying to receive from God without having a revelation of God. Jesus is revealing himself through the cross. And when he does, when they see him as he is, he recognizes. And this is what I love. Notice Jesus never says, hey, sinner, you need me. Jesus dies with dignity. He reveals who he is, and the man says he recognizes his need for Jesus. This is why you never have to beat people over the head about being saved, because people know they're a mess. Come on. Yes, sir. Truth. People know they're bad. People know they got issues. And it kills me how much time we waste beating on people and telling them, you're a sinner, you need Jesus, you're going to hell, and doing all that. They already know that. Most of them, if they're a good sinner, they know. I knew when I was a good sinner. If you're a bad sinner, you're in the wrong program. Anyway, talk about that later. Here's the thing, though. Jesus is revealing himself. Sam's like, I ain't coming back. You got to see this. He's revealing himself. And once you see him for who he is, the conflict is that you can't stay the same. That's really the conflict of conviction, is that when I really see who Jesus is, I'm challenged. This is why I don't spend a lot of time beating up people about getting saved, because what it really tells me is they haven't recognized who he is. One or two things are happening. One, they're lying. Or two, they're hiding the conviction. They're lying and hiding the conviction. Well, God hasn't revealed himself to them. And how can you be mad at someone who God hasn't revealed himself to? Okay, can I show you something? It just hit me. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Y'all remember when Jesus, this is for free, Jesus is chilling with the disciples. He sends them out two by two, right? There's like 72, two groups. Two each, 26, no, 36. About 72 disciples go out. And they go out two by two, two by two. And they're going out and they minister and they run back to Jesus. Like, Jesus, you won't believe what just happened. Jesus is like, holla at your boy, what happened? They're like, yo, Jesus, fam. Dudes will run back like, yo, what happened? They're like, Jesus, we just went over there. We casted out demons. We did it. We casted out demons. Jesus is like, and? They're like, what you mean we cast demons, Jesus? Like, we did it. He's like, nah, that's easy. You can do that all the time. He said, you should really rejoice because your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Okay, what he was saying is, you shouldn't rejoice over the activity that you're able to do in my name. You should rejoice that I've been revealed to you. The praise is in the revelation of who he is. This is why you don't have to beg people to worship and come on, lift your hand. Come on, don't you love God? Don't you do this? Don't you do that? Come on. You do all that craziness. No, maybe they don't really have a revelation. They got church, but no revelation. They got religion, but no revelation. Oh, they heard a couple scriptures, no revelation. They heard some songs, but no revelation. Next time we worship together and you see people sitting there, don't get mad at them. Realize they have no revelation, but there's a response from those who have a revelation. I lift my hands and I lift my voice and I dance and I scream and I do what I do because he has been revealed. There's a conflict of conviction, and the conflict causes me not to be comfortable where I've been. There's a conflict. Conflict doesn't let me live the way I used to live. Doesn't mean I'm perfect, but it means I'm working and stepping towards perfection. It means these areas of my life that I know that I'm not good in yet, I'm trying to get better. It's not that I'm doing this thing by my own work and my own will. It doesn't mean that I'm saved by my works, because I'm not. It's just when I'm saved, he saves me to good works. I'm not saved by good works, but I'm saved to good works. So when I am saved, I want to do the things that please him. I want to do the things that draw me closer. I want to do the opposite of what I used to do. The conflict of conviction means that I can't be comfortable. Yeah. And Peter had the same conflict, because Jesus says, who do men say I am? And he's like, what's the word? He goes on his Facebook, and he's like, hold up, let me see. Oh, shoot, yo, somebody said I'm Moses. Yo, this dude called me Elijah. And he's reading it, and he says, hold on. He said, hold on, let me put my phone down. He says, Peter, who do you say I am? Peter said, you are the Son of the living God. Jesus said, flesh and blood has not revealed that to you, but my Father. In other words, there's a conflict now. Now that I've been revealed, you can't see anything the same. The moment that I'm revealed, everything changes. And that's what I wanted to get you to. Crucial conflict. Walking with God means that he has been revealed in a way that causes me to live in a different way. And there's many of you right now who are in conflict because you've tried to live comfortable in your old life, but because he's been revealed, you can't stay the same. Can we go deeper next week? I promise I'll preach better next week. Pray for your boy. But I want to tell you right now, there's some of you that feel convicted. There's some of you that feel broken. You got tears in your eyes. You're trying to figure out this weird feeling. It's not the fish that you had. It's not breakfast. It's none of that. You know what it is? It's the Holy Spirit. And he is saying, I'm knocking at the door. And I want you to open. And I want you to come. I want you to join me. I don't care what religion you've been in. I'm revealing myself. I don't care how many times you messed up. I'm revealing myself. I don't care what church you've been to. I'm revealing myself. I don't care if your parents have been saved. I'm revealing myself. I don't care what you call yourself. I'm revealing myself. And when I reveal myself, you can't stay the same. And I'm not just talking about those that need to accept Jesus as Lord today, but I'm talking about even those that have accepted Jesus as Lord, but you stopped that salvation. Some of y'all stopped at the door. You got in, you like, woof, I made it. But there's so much more. There's so much more. There's a crucial conflict. He's causing you to move in the uncomfortable. Let's pray for a moment, because I'm telling you, I feel God in this place. Somebody right now, somebody needs this moment. Somebody's making a decision to go in a different direction. Somebody's changing their life right now. Your life is never going to be the same because of the conflict that's happening from the revelation of Jesus. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word and thank you for every promise. Thank you for what you're doing in us. God, even though we're uncomfortable right now, you've challenged us, you've poked at us, you've knocked down some idols in our mind and some things in our heart, and you've messed with us a little bit. God, we don't want to stop at a feeling. We want to walk into a knowing. We want to know you for ourselves. We want to accept you as God. We want to accept you as Lord, not just for salvation, but for direction. Give us life and light. Let your word be a lamp and a light. Let the voice of the Holy Spirit speak to us, direct us, lead us, and guide us. God, today we need a shift. We need a change. As we walk with you, bring us to a new level of understanding. Give us a new desire. Give us a new palate for you. Give us more desire for deeper things. We're tired of being surface. We're tired of just carrying the label as a Christian but not living the life. God, help us to go after the deeper things in Jesus' name. And there's somebody right now that needs to give your life to Jesus. And just do this with me, and we got to go. Come on, babe. Come on, worship team. We're going to do this right now. Just repeat this with me. Say, Father God, please forgive me for all of my sins. I recognize that I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. And I thank you for accepting me just as I am. I recognize that Jesus is Lord. that he died for my sins and he rose from the dead. And because of this, I'm saved, I'm healed, I'm whole, and I'm new. In Jesus' name. Listen, not only are the angels celebrating the thousands of you that accepted Jesus today, but Motivation is celebrating you for giving your life to Jesus. And we welcome you to the family of God. You are engrafted in. You are saved by grace through faith. You have a new life, and today it begins. Listen, if that's you, put a one up in the comments so our team can get in touch with you and talk to you about this new life with Jesus Christ.
You've been so good. You've been so good. You've been so good. You've been so good.
One time, you've been.
You've been so good.
Thanks so much for being here with our online experience today.
Make sure you connect with us through the week online at motivationchurch.org, as well as Facebook and Instagram. One thing we truly value at Motivation is our community. And whether today is your first time or you're a regular at Motivation, the best way to stay connected with our family is by filling out a connection link. That is posted in the comment section below. We hope that God spoke to you in a special way today, and our hope is that you feel the love of God stronger than before. Thanks again for being with us, and we'll see you next week.